Welcome back to the last and final installment of Organic Chemistry 2 Synthesis. Today we'll delve into a quick introduction to protecting groups and their role in multi-step organic synthesis. Let's have a look at the principal working mechanism of protecting groups on the example of peptide synthesis. Now, what are peptides? Peptides are essentially made up of many amino acids, yeah, as few as two, yeah, in a dipeptide. And if you have like a couple of them, you form oligopeptides, or if you form even longer chains, like in this particular case, you form a polypeptide. Yeah. Peptides are held together by amide bonds. So it is this particular constellation here, O double bond C, yeah, from the C to the nitrogen. Yeah, so these are amide bonds which hold these structures together. Yeah, amide bonds are particularly strong because you get delocalization of this nitrogen lone pair here across this amide bond and of course back. So you have essentially partial double bond character of this carbon nitrogen bond. Yeah, so these peptide bonds are chemically and thermally very stable. Now, how would we go about making those? Well, in principle, all you need is a carboxylate, or a carboxylic acid and an amine functionality. Yeah, so the amine, of course, as you know by now, is a good nucleophile. Yeah, but the carboxylic acid itself, yeah, is not a great electrophile. Yeah, simply because in the presence of amine, you would immediately deprotonate the carboxylic acid. Yeah, and your carboxylate, as you know, yeah, you can delocalize this negative charge all over the carboxylate. So it's a very stable anion. Yeah, so it's not very good for a nucleophilic attack. Yeah, so we need to activate this carboxylic acid somehow. Yeah, only then can you actually form your amide here on the right hand side. And so this is a condensation mechanism in principle, and you would kick out water at the end. Right, now there are many ways how to chemically activate carboxylic acids, and we've come across one of them, yeah, using thionyl chloride, yeah, SOCl2. So this you see below, so you essentially use SOCl2 to turn your carboxylic acid into an acid chloride, yeah. So this is now activated and set up, yeah, for peptide synthesis. However, we still face a problem. Yeah, so even if you consider an activated carboxylic acid and would like to react it, so here you have your activated carboxylic acid here, yeah, for example, as an acid chloride, and here you have your amine functionality. Yeah, so this is now activated. Yeah, and you want this particular amine here on the right hand side to react. Yeah, so you want this to be the nucleophile. Yeah, but you still have another amine functionality here, which you don't want to react, and you have here in principle your your OH of your carboxylic acid, and you don't want to react that either. Yeah, so how will we go about this? Well, the solution is on the right hand bottom right hand side. We would use protecting groups. Yeah, so here we have protecting group 1 to protect our amine, and protecting group 2 to protect our carboxylate, our carboxylic acid. Yeah, and now you are set up for the reaction. So you have your activated carboxylic acid and your amine free to give your protected dipeptide. And now, depending on the nature of your protecting groups, you could either remove both of them to get your naked dipeptide, or you could selectively deprotect either the amine or the carboxylic acid end for subsequent reactions. So now let's have a look in the following how such protecting groups would actually look like. So here we have three common protecting groups for amines. So let's discuss all of them one by one. So the first example is the BOC group. Essentially, whenever you have an acronym, it's probably a mouthful to be had. And this is, in fact, the reagent for attaching the BOC group onto the amine. And that's di-tertiary butyl dicarbonate. So BOC2O, or dicarbonate, and that is effectively now set up to react with a nitrogen lone pair. So these carbons here are extremely delta positive. You can flip the charge around here and attach your BOC group to the amine. So what you generate here, essentially this bit, is your carbamate. Now, there is a shorthand version for this as well. We can essentially write this out as RN-BOC-H. Now we also need a tactic for how to remove this BOC group. So the BOC group is stable to most things except extreme heat and strong acids. So using triflic acid, for example, TFA, we can remove the BOC group again to get our deprotected amine at the end. Then as a second example, the FMOC group, this derives from fluorinyl methoxycarbonyl. And it can be abbreviated analogously to the BOC group as RNFMOCH. Now this protecting group is stable to all but basic conditions. So essentially, when we subject this to base, for example, piperidine, in DMF, dimethylformamide, we get our deprotected amine. Finally, the CBZ group, from benzyl chloroformate. Again, same trick. You generate your carbamate, which can be again abbreviated for shorthand as RNCBZH. Now that is stable to most things, but we can still cleave it off using hydrogen over palladium catalyst. Yeah, so palladium on activated carbon. And like so, we again recover our deprotected amine. We have also several tools at our disposal for protecting alcohols. Yeah, so here, three common examples for alcohol protecting groups. First one on this in the series is the benzol group. Yeah, so here we can react a benzol chloride. With our alcohol, yeah, and pyridine as a base, and again the shorthand for this is ROBZ, and we can deprotect our alcohol using potassium carbonate in methanol, for example, yeah, to recover the free alcohol here again. Yeah. Second example is the benzyl group. Yeah, from benzyl bromide, for example. Oops. Yeah. So this would be. Let's remove that. So the shorthand for that would be ROBN. Yeah, it's stable to most things. Yeah, but again, we have the option to cleave that off with hydrogen over palladium catalyst. Yeah, to get our deprotected alcohol. And as a final example, the TBDMS group. Yeah, so this is tertiary butyl chlorodimethyl silane. The reagent, yeah, or TBDMSCl for short, and here you generate this oxygen silicon bond, yeah, again as shorthand ROTBDMS, TBDSM. No, TBDMS, Jesus, my apologies. And we can cleave that group off with essentially a fluoride source. Yeah, so silicon binds to oxygen quite well, yeah, but the silicon fluoride, yeah, or fluorine bond is even stronger. Yeah, so we need an F minus source. And one which is sort of okay to handle is TBAF, yeah, or tetra N-butyl ammonium fluoride. So you got your fluorine, the fluoride there, and an ammonium, butyl ammonium compounds. There we go. Yeah, I'll just write this out again. Yeah, so TBAF. Tetra N butyl ammonium fluoride. And yeah, as I said, the F minus, the fluoride, will then cleave this oxygen silicon bond, and we recover our free alcohol. So let's put what we've learned so far in organic chemistry 2 to some use. Yeah, so you remember we've discussed a couple of organic functional groups, yeah, amines, alcohols in particular, but also acids and alkenes and the corresponding pKa values. Yeah, so using these pKa values, we can now make predictions on how to interconvert all of these compounds. Yeah. So let's remind ourselves of the pKa values here. For example, for an alkene, yeah, so that's around 50. Yeah, simply because R minus would be such a bad leaving group in alkenes. Yeah, 33 for amines, 16 for alcohols, 5 for carboxylic acids, and -5 around about there for hydrochloric acid. Yeah, so now using these pKa values, we also have a measure of how good a leaving group the anion actually is. Yeah, so as we go down in pKa value, yeah, we get better leaving groups in water. Yeah, so now we can essentially say thermodynamically, yeah, we can pretty much convert the acid chloride here, which you see on the top left hand side of your slide. Just bring up the laser pointer. Yeah, thermodynamically we can interconvert, yeah, react this acid chloride with let's say with amines, yeah, that are good nucleophiles, to any of the other compounds you see here in the series. Yeah, simply because chloride is such a good leaving group, yeah, low in energy, and amines are good nucleophiles, yeah, high in energy. Yeah, so how would we go about this? Let's draw this in. Yeah, so going from our acid chloride here on the top left hand side of the slide, yeah, to get to the acid anhydride. Yeah, we could immediately react it with, say, a carboxylate anion. Yeah, to go from the acid anhydride to the ester. Yeah, we can react this with an alcohol, for example. Yeah, and to, how will we get from the acid chloride to the ester? Well, again, an alcohol. And now from the ester, yeah, to get to the amide. We could react that with, say, a secondary amine. Yeah, likewise, going from the acid chloride, yeah, from the acid anhydride, or from the ester, we could get straight to the amide by reaction with an appropriate secondary amine here in this case. Yeah, and esters, by the way, yeah, just as a side note, esters are usually the way how we protect carboxylic acids. Finally, a summary slide of the chemical properties of amines compared to alcohols. Yes, we discussed the pKa and the pKb values are a good guide for how these how their reactivities would compare. And note pKa plus pKb equals 14, as you remember. Yeah, so alcohols and amines can potentially act as acids. Yeah, they are not terribly good acids, yeah, as you see by their pKa values, But using a strong enough base, you could deprotonate both of them. Yeah. Now the alcoholate is of course a much better leaving group than a deprotonated amine, as you remember. Both of them can act as bases as well. Yeah. So alcohol can pick up a proton. Yeah. And so can our amine to give our tertiary amine salt, for example. Both of them can also act as nucleophiles. Yeah. So, for example, you could react a alcohol as a nucleophile with an appropriate alkyl halide, for example, or with some other good leaving group X. Yeah. So you would essentially then here deprotonate again to recover your product. Likewise, you can react your amines with alkyl halides, yeah, to the secondary amine. And as you remember from the previous slides, this reaction could happen two more times to give us our tertiary amine, yeah, and then our quaternary ammonium cation, yeah. Alcohols can also act as electrophiles, yeah, if activated appropriately. So the moment that you protonate your alcohol, yeah, you essentially turn OH into a good leaving group, yeah, and then you could let me just draw this in, yeah, come in with an appropriate nucleophile, yeah, and react it with your R plus, yeah. Amines only very rarely react as electrophiles. So, and that brings us to the end of Organic Chemistry 2 synthesis, and in fact the end of the course. Now, as a pointer for revisions, there are a couple of chapters and subchapters in Clayton Warren and Wover's Organic Chemistry book, yeah, that you have hopefully made use of throughout the course, but a couple of chapters are of particular importance, in particular chapter 8, 14 and 24, if you would like to delve a little bit deeper into this matter. So chapter 8 goes into pKa values, 14 into alcohols and amines, and chapter 24 into protecting groups. So thank you very much for your attention. And hopefully see you for some more advanced chemistry and advanced organic chemistry in particular in the next year.